be presenting some ideas on the gravitational, electrostatic, and nuclear forces. I'll try to correlate this with second law of thermodynamics, and very obviously, my sole intention is to tell you perpetual motion machine of first or second kind. Simply cannot be designed. Now, since motivation is one of the very important topics in today's discussion, I need to explain what is my motivation behind taking this particular topic for discussion here. I have met a number of people, quite educated, rich, very resourceful. Majority of people, they have a confusion. Whenever they come across regenerative technology, this particular term comes, they perceive that if you go on a bike brake, the vehicle will generate electricity out of it. And from that electricity, you can manage to run the car. So they believe that such a car will never require a refueling, because brake matter no gaadi chalta rahega. This was the expression from one of the industrialists in Jamshedpur. And he was trying to convince me that, boss, you may be a mechanical engineer, but you do not know the technology. Mercedes has come with the technology. You apply brakes, it will regenerate electricity, and with that electricity, the car can run. Now, this particular confusion is a universal confusion. Why this confusion arises? What is the exact reason why we cannot have a device like that? What this particular fancy word, perpetual motion machine, what I have acronymed as PMM, is? I'd like to speak about that. In particular, I'll speak about gravitational force, electrostatic force, nuclear forces, and it will appear out of context, but this is very much in context. I'll speak about second law of thermodynamics, then I'll speak about perpetual motion machine, how probable it is scientifically. And there are some pictures which I have taken, which will be used in the presentation. That has been taken from Creative Commons. The idea of gravitational force, we believe that it has originated from the concepts of Sir Isaac Newton, and it dates back to 1680. We all know, mathematically, it is F, gravitationally G, m1, m2 upon r squared. This is one of the fundamental inverse square forces of nature. What it tells us is, gravitation attracts everything in this universe that has mass to everything else in the universe that has mass. Now, let's take an idea what exactly this statement means. It means, I have two balloons. They tend to attract each other. So two balloons hanging from a thin wire, they'll have a tendency to come together and get attached. This is known. We know of it. We experience this. But a mathematical quantization of the constants, capital G, that was made by Cavendish. The experiment is very simple. This particular figure, this is important for you. It is important for me also. Because to repeat Cavendish experiment, absolutely nothing extra is required. The two dumbbells in our gym and two small marble balls, they will suffice. And believe me, you can practically calculate the value of capital G. Experiment is very simple. I'll not speak on that. And by now, we know that the capital G has a value of 6.67408, 10 to the power minus 11, whatever would be the units, and small g, acceleration due to gravity, is 9.81 meter per second square. This does not interest you till now. I understand that. Next is, what is the impact of this? The impact is, the three fundamental laws of motion, Newton's first law, second law, third law, they practically need to have a basis. A scientist cannot simply come forth and say that, look, these are my rules, these are the laws, and you need to study it in your textbook from tomorrow. So obviously, anything like that, if it is presented, it must shall have a basis. So the previous expression, that was the basis. And on the basis of that only, now there were certain things which were answered. Many whys and hows, they were explained. Like, how the moon manages to orbit without falling on the earth. This was one. Second, many satellites, they have different perigee and apogee. How it happens. This also could be explained with this particular theory. And finally, a new discipline of study called Newtonian mechanics that was to be born. But you should remember that this is nearly 400 years old. And there is a figure, rather a cartoon, which shows Newton really puzzled looking at the falling apple. Then, nearly 100 years after this particular work, came the work of TEDxNERIST. His formulation that relates to charged particles. You will see, in this particular case also, the forces are inverse square forces. That means as you increase the distance of separation between the two charged particles, the forces, they do not decrease linearly, but they decrease as an inverse square function. The constant of proportionality, 1 by 4 by epsilon naught, which is generally written as k, that has been experimentally defined, and we settled down for 9 × 10⁻⁹ Newton meter square per coulomb square. And this particular force, this has been well experimented, and theory is well established. The problem starts now. Now, there is Newton, there is Coulomb, and by the side of that, the person is Rutherford. Now, when you take a look at the first two forces, both are inverse square forces. What it means is, before that, I need to explain why Rutherford is there. Rutherford's experiment that clarifies to us that mass of the matter that remains inside the nucleus, and it is composed of protons and neutrons. Theory says neutron is neutral, it doesn't have a charge. Protons are positively charged. Electron is not into scenario because we're discussing the nucleus. Now, we have two forces acting. The first force is the force of gravitation, which pulls the protons together. But since the protons are positively charged particles and they are so close to each other, there is force of repulsion. So the situation is something like this. I have a carabao filled with the coins. The force of attraction between the coins is a very weak force. And the force of repulsion, which acts between all the white coins, is gigantic. Black coins are neutral. It doesn't interfere with others. So in the scenario when the white coins, they want to fly apart, they don't want to stay together, this force is gigantic. And the small force, which tries to keep the white coins together, is feeble. What exactly should be the condition of the carabao? All the coins together, or the coins spread it out? Logically, it appears that it should be spread it out. But the observation, what Rutherford experiment that has given to us, it essentially tells us that no, the coins are held together. This means there is a precise limitation to the forces which has been explained by Newton and the force that has been explained by Coulomb. We call this force as the nuclear force. The force of attraction as dictated by Newton's law and the force of repulsion or attraction as dictated by Coulomb's law. Practically, it does not hold good in nuclear domain. Since it doesn't hold good in nuclear domain, it means there are some different type of forces as well. And we term those forces as nuclear forces. Fundamental difference between the other two forces of nature and the nuclear force is, the nuclear force this will not follow inverse square law. This will be proportional to 1 by r. So there will be a linear variation. And there will be precisely three zones of distances in limits of Fermi meters, wherein in one part there will be very strong attraction, and in other parts it will be repulsive. And after a while, beyond 2.8 Fermi meter, the force will become negligible. This explains as to how the nucleus that remains bound together, even here, the positive charges, they tend to repel each other with a great force. Having said that, now I come to the laws of thermodynamics. These were the fundamental laws of motion. Now is the laws of thermodynamics. We study three laws with the name zero, first, and second. Third law is there, but I will not touch upon that. Of these three, the first law, it speaks only about a concept of a device called a thermometer. First law is a restatement of law of conservation of energy. And the second law of thermodynamics, it's a real mystery. Why I say it is a mystery? In colloquial Hindi, there is a saying, Hari Anand, Hari Katha Ananta, Sunahi Kahani Bahu Bidhi Sab Sanda. What it means is, the forms are really infinite, and the wise one, they explain in their own languages. Similar is the second law of thermodynamics. How I have studied is very different from how it is taught by the teachers in Department of Physics and how it is taught by the teachers in Department of Chemistry. At the first instance, it appears as if all the statements for the second law of thermodynamics are independent. Whether they are related or not is very difficult to make out. But there is a single essence to the second law of thermodynamics. It sets a limit on efficiency of a machine that could be designed. And the second law of thermodynamics says you cannot design anything which will have 100% efficiency. But then, mind of man and the hearts of man can be very easily corrupted. And hence, even the educated engineer, he tends to believe that second law of thermodynamics, it can be defined. And one of the very simple ways of defining second law of thermodynamics is, hold a magnet in front of a big piece of metal and hold the magnet in a stick, and with the stick you sit in the car which holds the piece of iron. And in fact, it was there in the PPT. I'll have to speed it up, but that was to come from the visual. So the expectation is the piece of iron will get attracted to the magnet, and the magnet and the person holding the magnet is sitting on the car. And hence, the car will continuously follow the magnet and it will move. This is called a perpetual motion. That means you are generating motion from nowhere. It is free. Something like you are sitting on a horse and with a stick you are holding carrot and grass in front of the horse. So the horse continuously runs to eat it and you manage a free gallop. This perpetual motion machine, this has really kept the human mind occupied for many generations, many hundred years, and people still keep working on that. From second law of thermodynamics and from the macroscopic view, the view which follows Newton's law and the Coulomb's law, perpetual motion machine is an absolute no. But then I'll present a very simple mental experiment. There is a hailstorm and there is a car. Hail descends from all directions. The direction is random. Since the direction is random, it means effectively there is no energy transfer. Because there is no momentum transfer, there is no energy transfer. So the car, if it is hit by hail in one direction, after a while it will be hit by a hail in another direction. So that if the car has moved a little distance to the left, after a while, it will come back to the same position. And it comes back to the same position, effectively, no work is done. Since the motion of the hail particles is also random, there is no energy associated with that. Like the Brownian motion and all random motions. Now, I cleverly make a readjustment in the whole system. The driver, he sits inside the car with a single job. His job is to simply keep a foot on the brake pedal and press the pedal rhythmically. As he presses the pedal rhythmically, look at the situation, what it faces. Say the brake pedal, it is fitted with the one-way wheel. In one of the innovators, the one-way wheel was used to pull water from the well. The similar one-way wheel is fitted with the brakes, and the driver is continuously paddling. What it means is, the hell from one direction will try to push the car ahead. But since there is a one-way wheel, hail from the other direction, it will push it back. So from random motion, you are able to generate a directional motion. And if a directional motion is created, you have created that motion from nowhere. Because the initial hill, the direction of its flow was random. This is conceptually a perpetual motion machine, but practically impossible. Because mass of a car, it is so huge, forget hill, even cricket balls, they cannot make a car move simply by hitting it from one side. But if you think of the same thing on nano level, assumption was the nucleus there is of the size of Fermi's, so obviously 10 times larger than that. On nano level, if you think of the same phenomenon, there is random motion of particles, the fats, proteins inside of you. Now, if this directional selection is made, obviously it will be possible for the protein molecules to push the fat molecules in a single direction. That means now inside of you, the fat molecule, it can be channeled in a particular direction by virtue of the random motion of the protein molecules, the motion of which is practically random. So it appears that perpetual motion machine of second kind, it may be possible at nano-level. Like those who have taken the whole discussion very seriously, do you agree that at nano-level, perpetual motion machine can be created? There is another bad news. It started with the bad news at the starting. There is another bad news. The answer is no. Even there, perpetual motion machine cannot be created because the random motion, it cannot be generated free of cost. The random motion of particles, that depends on the temperature at which the fluid is maintained. And if you have to maintain temperature, obviously you'll have to feed energy. And once you feed energy, just to create the random motion, that means whatever motion you're getting is not at all free. Examples are the warm-blooded animal. Even if it doesn't try to shake a finger, still it will have to eat something to survive. Because just to maintain the body temperature, you'll have to take energy. Second example, the most swift of the snakes is unable even to move when it is weakless. Because there is no random motion of the protein or the fat molecules which will propel the required fat molecule at a particular location with which the snake will make a jump. Having said all this, it appears to me that all the laws, what has been propounded by our scientists, perhaps all of them are right. But we need to maintain a check and balance between what is the situation, which of the laws of nature will be applicable there. Whenever you make a decision of designing something, please keep in your mind, second law of thermodynamics probably cannot be defined. That's the message. Thank you.